We'll go ahead and get started. Start off by saying Shalom. All praises to the Most High. Tonight's lesson, we're going to hit some information on the government and the churches, how the government and the churches are working together. So that's what tonight's lesson is going to be about. So tonight's lesson will be called Churches and Government. And we're going to show tonight how those two work together. All right, so churches / government. Just got a lot of different things going on right now. We've already been doing a lot of lessons over the last week and a half or so, just talking about the martial law, different things like that. Last week we also did a lesson with talking about plagues and GMOs, how we have vaccinations in the food, how they now are putting vaccinations in mosquitoes like they did with the West Nile virus a few years back. So, you know, a lot of people are starting to stand up and say we're not getting vaccinations, so now they're putting vaccinations in the food and the mosquitoes. So we're in the end days, a lot of different things are happening. So I wanted to go into some precepts about how the churches are involved. And you know, at the end of last week's lesson, Sister Paige brought up a good topic on something that she was reading, so it made me go do a little more research on it. And that's kind of what we're going to talk about tonight. So tonight we'll start off in Psalms 119, verse 126. So Psalms 119, verse 126. Okay. And we're just going to hit the information on how the government has these churches tied into what they're doing. Okay. So with that in mind, Brother James, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Brother James wasn't feeling too good tonight, but the brother's going to read online. Okay. He'll read the scriptures. And if he can get to the information that you guys are going to hit on Google. So remember, get your phones ready or your computers ready. I'm going to give you a couple of articles we're going to go to show you this. So tonight's lesson is called Churches / Government. All right, we're going to start off in Psalms 119, verse 126. Go ahead, Brother James.
Sorry, brother, I'm getting the script right.
All right. Go ahead and read whenever you got it.
Psalms 119 and what?
126. You want me to start it while you get it?
No, I got it. I just got it.
All right, go ahead.
All right, we're in the book of Psalms, chapter 119, verse 126. And it reads, it is time for you, O God, to work, but they have made void thy law.
Okay. No, that's all we need. So it says, it is time for thee, the Most High, to work, for they have made void thy law. So the Most High said it's time for him to go work because they have made void his law. Who is he talking about? He's talking about the people that are in charge, the government. He's talking about these preachers that are in charge of the people, the flock. And remember, the government is a key word tonight because we're going to hit some scripture tonight that's going to show you that the government is all the way alive, but yet in this world, they try to tell you that the government is the right way to go. I'm going to give y'all the breakdown on void. Void is H 6565. Void is H 6565. And it's para. Para. Which is P-A-R-A-R. Para. And void means to break up. That is to violate. Okay, so Psalms 119 and 126 says, it is time for thee, the Most High, to work. It's time for him to go to work, for they have made void thy law. They have broke his law. They have violated his law. Okay, so now the Most High knows these people have violated his law. It's time for him to go to work. And you know, majority of these churches, 9 out of 10 churches, if not all of these churches, teach the people that they don't have to follow the laws and the commandments anymore. So they have violated what the Most High put out there for us to do. Okay? On March 7th of 2006, the Bush administration in 2006 put into law a brand new executive order. Executive Order 13397 and 13397 was a law that was put in place for the separation of the church and state and forces all churches with 501c3 status. So what 501c3 status is, 501c3 status is when a organization can go and fill out nonprofit paperwork, and nonprofit is just nonprofit. But if you get 501c3, now you're way big in the nonprofit organization. Okay? And the government funds you money when you get the 501c3. The government will fund you money to run your programs. So it says, in 2006, the Bush administration put in a brand new executive order, 13397, that removes the separation of church and state and forces all churches with 501c3 status to become government agencies. Let me read it again. In 2006, the Bush administration put into law Executive Order 13397 that removes the separation of church and state and forces all churches with 501c3 status. So if you go ask your pastor, hey, y'all got the 501c3? And he say, yeah. All churches with 501c3 status, 501c3 status to become government agencies. So any church you know or any pastor that has a 501c3, he is part of the government. Okay, go to Google and put in Executive Order 13397. Go to Google, put in Executive Order EXECUTIVE Order 13397. And go down to number 3. And when you go down to number 3, it should say Executive Order 13397, Church as Governmental agency. Y'all find that? Brother James, you find that? Brother James, you there?
Yes, I got it.
You found it?
Yeah.
Okay, you want to go ahead and read that? Read a little louder. Read a little louder because you're online, so read a little louder.
I got you, man.
Go ahead.
I got it. Executive Order 13397. It says, signed by President George W. Bush on March 7, 2010. Concerning the responsibilities.
Hold on. You're not in the right one. Are you in, number three? Is it, y'all find it?
So I go down.
Use with views?
News
with views, is that what it say?
Yes, with views.
News with views, is it number three though?
Yes.
Yeah, go down three and it's news with views. Yeah, Google Executive Order 13397.
I apologize.
And once you do that, go down three, and it should be newswithviews.com.
Do I click on the first link?
No, it's the third link. The third link was called News with Views.
My third link is Nancy Levin.
Yeah, that's her. Go ahead, click on that.
Okay, now start with the church.
Yeah, the separation of the church. Go ahead.
Yes, I will not that one. The separation of the church and state gone with the scope of 18. As of March 7th, 2015, our nation's leaders signed another executive order.
Hold on for a second. Can you guys that are online, can y'all hear Brother James?
Yeah.
Okay. Go ahead, brother.
Okay. It says, the separation of church and state gone with the scope of 18 as of March 7, 2006, our nation's leaders signed another executive order, which tied the Department of Homeland Security to our leaders and expanded churches. Okay, all you nonprofit churches out there, you now serve the federal government primary fine agency. That is now your primary function. You are now officially organized in the
So, these churches that have 501c3s are now under the federal government and they are spying agencies. That's what that just says. And it says, these churches are now, that's their primary function. You churches, you big old churches, that have all these programs that are sponsored with your 501c3, you are now spying agencies, and that's your primary function for the government. How do you know what church has a 501c3? Go look at it. All these huge churches. You go to a church that's really, really huge, and they have a daycare program. They have a library. They have a mini school. They have all these different programs because they're being sponsored by the government and they are spying agencies. Paragraph 2.
Or in paragraph 2, when it reads, I would feel sorry for the past minister and rabbi, except for the fact that I just can't. How stupid and positively corrupt can you possibly be to take money in exchange for manipulating your thoughts and giving you sheep to the national slaughter? And will you also spot on your cross and provide reports to your master?
So it says, how stupid and possibly corrupt can you possibly be just to take some money by manipulating your flocks? Alright? And it says, will you also spy on your flocks and provide reports to your new master? So that's their job. Their job is to spy on the flocks and provide reports to the master. Alright? Which is the government. You know what, Ike, I might read it because I don't know if you're going to sound loud enough for the recording of the video. I can barely hear you. All right? Paragraph 3 says, in exchange for money, have you agreed to pacify and organize your flocks in the event of a national emergency? You certainly have, for you have been ordered to do so, and have you been ordered to offer your buildings, your resources, and your labor forces called congregations to serve your newly declared administration. So it's telling you that these churches not only have they've been manipulated to spy on you and report back to the government, but they're going to use their buildings when that time comes for FEMA camps. And not only are they going to use their buildings for FEMA camps, but they are getting money to send you to the FEMA camps. So not only are they going to send you to the FEMA camps, and not only are the preachers going to teach their people to go to the FEMA camps, but the building that they congregate at is going to turn into a FEMA camp. Next paragraph. I tried to come up with words to describe how I feel about this executive order and the churches that have patterned themselves to this system. The words don't come minus the fact that the church has completely and irreversibly fallen to the lowest and darkest common denominator, which is the total betrayal of souls of the faithful. I would pray for your forgiveness, but I don't want to. So it's telling you right here that these churches, okay, have sold their souls to the government to sell you out. That's basically what this is saying. The churches have sold their souls, these preachers have sold their souls to the government for money to sell you out when the Big Bang happens. The next paragraph. Nor do I want to write about this sickening topic, but I appeal to Christian people to, one, ask your church leaders if they are faith-based funded. So just like I said, if somebody is listening to this lesson and you go to church and you go to a huge, humongous church, go ask your leader, your preacher, if that church is funded by the government. Two, to leave those churches and start home-based churches with your friends and family members. That's what we're doing. Do not support executive order, Department of Homeland Security churches with your presence of your money. All right? You are being manipulated and reported upon, guaranteed. So these churches are going back and telling the government everything that's going on. Next one. You are being told what to do when more crisis hits the nation. So it tells you that the government is teaching the preachers what to tell the flock. So when a crisis hits the nations, these preachers are telling these flock it's okay to go to the FEMA camp. The government is okay. The mark of the beast, it's okay. You'll still be saved. All right? You can go talk to a preacher tomorrow and tell them, hey, well, you know about the mark of the beast, right? And if you get the mark, you're not saved. They'll tell you a whole story on what the mark of the beast is, and it won't have nothing to do with what the Bible's talking about. Because the government is teaching them that the mark of the beast is not a chip that's going to go in your hand, when the Bible is telling you just that. So you have to be real careful. That's what these preachers are doing. Go try it. Tomorrow, go call a preacher or a preacher that you know and ask him about the mark of the beast and see what story he gives you. Well, you know, it's just a system. It's not going to be a chip. It's not going to be nothing. So they're teaching their people, this is okay. It's all right. Don't be scared when this time comes. All right? As all is now planned down to our weather emergencies, which are provided to the training and relocation exercises for the real crisis to come. The one that permanently collapses the constitutional America. The church needs to regroup and gather in homes. So that's what we're doing. We're gathering in homes now where faith is restored, private, and truth is real. So it's telling you, this dude that wrote this, or this lady that wrote this article, is telling you that there is no truth in the churches. There is no truth. Why? Because when you go to church, it's about singing and dancing. They're twerking in churches now. Twerking. The people are twerking. There's nothing real that's going on in these churches. Pay your tithes. Come in. All right? And do whatever you want. Little kids, how do I get the kids to stay in the church and pay their tithes? Come in and twerk. Come in and sing Lil Wayne songs and stuff and have fun. Forget the church leadership. They are padding their pockets and socially re-engineering your mind with think tank religion and crisis management. And they're getting paid to do so, much like the public schools and mass media. So it tells you that these churches, these preachers are padlocking their pockets. Their pockets are getting fat to re-engineer your thinking, your brain process through these religions. Raise your churches in your homes. All you need is a Bible. One will do. Save yourselves and your souls and leave your new and improved church buildings. So like I said, fancy organs, fundraisers, and colorful windows behind. So any church that has all these new pianos, organs, they doing all these fundraisers, big old buildings, it said leave them behind. Go save your soul in a home-based church. Okay? As in all communist countries, the church will survive underground, so to speak. And with genuine prayer and serve your constitutional America, don't give up on freedom, even as it dissolves before your eyes. Be courageous in truth and gather together in truth. All right? So go back out of that, what we just read. Go back to Google. Now, Google. So now Google, pastor telling members, just like I say, pastor, put this in Google, pastor telling members to go to FEMA camps. Pastor telling members to go to FEMA camp. Put that in your Google bar and go down to number 2. The second link. Let me say it again. Pastor telling members to go to FEMA camps. And go down to link number 2. You guys find it? Yeah? The title says, pastors to help DHS in arrest and detention of Americans in FEMA camps. Pastors to help DHS in arrest and detention of Americans in FEMA camps. Let me read. The fact that FEMA has recruited up to an estimate 28,000 pastors as a low-end estimate. So that's a low-end estimate. FEMA has recruited an estimate of 28,000 pastors as a low-end estimate to as many as 100,000 pastors as a high-end estimate in order to form the clergy response team is very disturbing, not to mention frightening. The reports of pastoral betrayal are now coming in from multiple sources, and there is no denying where this is headed. Below is an interview that Alex Jones did with my friend Pastor Butch Paw. I have been on Pastor Butch's show many times, and my experience with him is that he is not only committed man of God, he is very serious researcher. In the following video, Pastor Butch tells Alex Jones how far FEMA's plot is to use pastors to entice willing self-incarceration into FEMA camps. So he tells you this pastor, I guess they came to him and he must have opted out and said, no, I'm not doing that. But it says that these pastors to entice willing self-incarceration into FEMA camps. So these pastors are now tricking people and lying to people to go to FEMA camps. All right? This is what we're getting today in our day and age. Pastors in the church, the leaders, people that calls themselves leaders, to go to FEMA camps. All right? Paragraph 3 says, as if the clergy response teams are not enough to convince you that your church has been compromised by the non-Christian forces connected to the globalists, then you need to consider the impact of 501c3 regulations and how they limit the preaching of the word of Ahia from the pulpits of America. So it tells you that any church that is 501c3, what we already read, is now government ran. All right. Bush in 2006 passed an executive order 13397 that if any church is 501c3 based, is now a federal agency. And their primary function is to spy on the members. All right? People have to understand what's going on. Let me read the rest. Stunning interview with pastor congressman admitting DHS IRS is telling pastors what they cannot say from the pulpit. So this is why these pastors are not in the church teaching people that they're Israel. This is why these pastors are not in the church teaching the full-blown truth. They're not teaching that the son of the Most High, which is Yeshua, is black. They're not teaching this stuff. They got a white Jesus up there and teaching people that as long as you believe in him, you can be saved. And the Bible don't say that. The Bible don't say as long as you believe in Jesus, you can be saved. The Bible says that salvation is of the Jews. And if you're not being taught who the true Jews are, how can you be saved? Point blank. And that's why so many people is going to fall by the wayside, because they don't have a clue who the true Jews are. Okay? Let's go to, grab your Bibles and let's go to John 4:22. St. John 4:22. Alright, St. John 4:22 says, ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. Alright, so these people in these religions, in these churches, they don't know what they're worshiping. Yeah, they've been taught they're Christian, but they don't do the research on it. They don't know what they're worshiping. But we know what we worship. We know clearly what we worship because we study, we research. And it says, for salvation is of the Jews. So if you're not being taught who the true Jews are, how are you going to receive salvation? These preachers are in the pulpit leading people straight to the pit. Let's go back to that article. It says, stunning interview with pastor congressman admitting DHS IRS is telling pastors what they cannot say from the pulpit. MSNBC interviewed a pastor who also happens to be the chairman of the Congressional Black Caucus, Emmanuel Cleaver. Representative Cleaver stated very clearly that preachers are being muzzled by the 501c3 regulations being enforced for the Justice Department and the IRS. In 2014, Representative Cleaver headed up a meeting with several thousand clergy along with representatives from FEMA, the IRS, and Eric Holder. Eric Holder is who? The guy from the White House, right? What's his position again? I can't remember. Department of... he's one of the guys. He's high position. According to Cleaver, the pastors minister to the total about 10 million Christians. That's a lot of Christians. 10 million people are being led astray by these 501c3 churches and being lied to. Attorney General. So Eric Holder is the Attorney General for Barack Obama. Cleaver clearly stated that the purpose of this meeting was to equip the pastors with what they need to know about what they can say and not say in the church. If you find this hard to believe, let the congressman tell you in his own words what I have written here. So if you have a hard time believing this, go look up Congressman Cleaver, and he'll and just go to YouTube and put in Congressman Cleaver and 501c3, and he'll probably tell you everything. Through the 501c3 regulations, DHS and FEMA have made it nearly possible for your pastor to tell you the truth as to what is coming. So a lot of these people don't have a clue about Jade Helm, what we talked about last week, how Jade Helm is about martial law. These preachers are not in the pulpit teaching these people what they need to know. So when all this stuff happens and when it comes, boom, it's going to be too late. All right. And then at the same time, the preacher is teaching the people that the FEMA camps is the way to go. Hey, if a disaster do happen, hey, trust in the government. You know, America's always going to get us out of it. Go to the FEMA camp so you can be protected, so ISIS don't cut your head off. This is what the preachers are telling the people. So when that time comes, they're going to go run into the FEMA camps. All right, next session. How common is the undermining of the church? As part of the clergy response team training, their initial and primary training was to tell their flock to obey DHS version of Romans 13. So the preachers have been taught through DHS, the government, teach your pulpit Romans 13, but don't teach them nothing else. Teach them Romans 13 about a natural disaster. Let's go to Romans 13. Let's see what they're teaching these people. And Romans 13 is probably one of the most misled scriptures in the Bible. These preachers read these scriptures, and this is probably one of the misled chapters in the Bible, Romans 13, because they use this chapter, the government and these preachers, and they use it for the wrong ways. They don't use it for what it said. Romans 13:1 says, "Let every soul be subject unto the high powers, for there is no power but of a higher. The powers that be are ordained of a higher." So it's telling you right here, let every soul be subject unto the high powers. And that's where they stop. Oh, you're supposed to be in subjection to the high powers, which is the government. But no, read on. It says, "For there is no power but a higher." So the power that it's talking about is a higher and his ministers. The power that be are ordained of a higher. So the ministers that are ordained through a higher, those are the higher powers that it's talking about. It's not talking about these preachers that have been ordained through DHS through this 501c3. Let me give you the definition for ordained, the Webster definition for ordained. Ordained, appointed, instituted, established, invested with ministerial or pastoral functions. Okay? But you have to be ordained by a higher. If you're going to be one of his ministers, you have to be ordained through him. Not through the spirit of the government or not through the spirit of your own heart. You have to be ordained through the Most High, through his word, so you can teach the flock the right way and the right path to go. Anybody that's teaching from their own heart, anybody that is teaching through the words of the government, is a liar. Okay? They're false. Let's go to 2 Peter 1:20. So anybody that's prophesying or anybody that has been ordained, it was through a higher. It's not through the government. And we just read here through these articles that up to 100,000 preachers have been ordained by DHS through the 501c3. Ain't that what we just read? So these preachers are being taught prophecy through the government and through the minds and the heart of the government and the minds of their selves. Let's see what the scriptures say though. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 19 says, "We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day of dawn. And the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of men, but holy men of the highest spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost." So it tells you that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. And these preachers are being ordained through DHS, which is the government, which is their own private interpretation. It says, "For the prophecy came not in the old time by the will of man." So prophecy doesn't come by the will of man, what a man thinks. "But holy man of a highest faith as they were moved by the Holy Spirit." So people, the vision comes through a dream, which will move you through the Holy Spirit. So that's how the Most High talked to his prophets back in the day. He would come to them and speak to them in a dream. How do we know that? Let's go to Numbers. Hold on, I believe it's Numbers 12 and 6. Yeah, number 12 and 6. Let's go to Numbers 12 and 6 to show you that the Most High in the old time, when he went to the holy man, he spoke to them in a vision. And that's how they got their prophecy. It wasn't through the men that get prophecy from their own interpretation. So if the Most High ain't coming to you in a vision, you ain't getting no prophecy. Numbers 12 and 6 says, "And he said, hear now my words. If there be a prophet among you, I, the Most High, will make myself known unto him in a vision, and I will speak unto him in a dream." So he says right here that I will speak to my prophets in a dream. I will make myself known unto him in a vision, and that's how they get their prophecy. All right? And let's just read the next one. Numbers 12 and 7. "My servant Moses is not so, who is faithful in all mine house. With him will I speak mouth to mouth, even apparently, and not in dark speeches." So it says Moses, he is not so. He's not a prophet. So a lot of people teach that Moses is a prophet, but right here it says Moses is not a prophet. Why is Moses not a prophet? He says, "Because in the similitude of the Most High shall behold. Wherefore then were ye not afraid to speak?" No, hold on. Okay, let me read verse 8 again. "With him will I speak mouth to mouth." So the Most High says, I speak to Moses mouth to mouth. So since he speaks to Moses mouth to mouth, that makes Moses what? The servant of Ahiah. Alright? So Moses was not a prophet, he was a servant. "With him will I speak mouth to mouth, even apparently, and not in dark speeches, and the similitude of the Most High shall behold. Wherefore then were ye not afraid to speak against my servant Moses." Moses is a servant. Alright? Let's go back to Romans 3 and 13 and 2. So these people are teaching you that you have to be in subjection to higher powers, which is the government. And that's not what Romans 13 is saying. Romans 13 is speaking of the ordained ministers through Ohio. Romans 13 and 2 speaks, "Whosoever therefore resists the power, resists the ordinance of Ahiah. And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation." So remember, we're going to these scriptures right here, because this is what the government is teaching these pastors to teach the people. So these pastors are teaching the people that if you don't follow the higher power, which is the government, and if you resist these people, you will get damnation. So remember, don't read it in the eyes that you know it is. Read it in the eyes of the deceitment that these pastors are teaching the people. This is what we're going over tonight. We're teaching the deceitment of how these pastors are betraying this chapter. Verse 3, for rulers are not a terror to good work, but to do evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is the minister of the Most High to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain, for he is the minister of the Most High, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. Wherefore ye must needs be subject, not only for wrath, but also for conscience sake. So it's telling you, you must be in subjection to these preachers and be in subjection to the government. For this cause pay you tribute also, for they are the highest ministers, attending continually upon this very thing. Render therefore to all their dues, tribute to whom tribute is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. So they say, hey, pay your dues to these higher powers. All right, don't be scared to pay your tithes. Give them all your money, because you're in subjection. Verse 8, owe no man anything but to love one another, for he that loveth another hath filled the law. So this is what they're teaching their people, but they're teaching them this in the wrong way. Go back to Google. They're not teaching this in the right concept. All right, so this is what the government is telling people with the 501c3. You can't teach certain things, but you can teach this chapter right here. Go back to Google, stay where we was at with the pastors telling members to go to FEMA camps, and just go down to link number 3 now. So we was in link number 2. Now go down to link number 3. And link number 3 says, secret FEMA plan to use pastors as pacifiers in preparation for martial law. You guys have that? Okay. So link number 3 says, secret FEMA plan. Let me say it just to make sure everybody's in the right spot. So we're in Google, and Google pastor telling members to go to FEMA camps. And go to link number 3. It's not 3. Yours is 3. What was yours? Number 6. Wow. Okay. So if yours is not number 3, then go to number 6 if you can't find what I'm reading. And it says, secret FEMA plan to use pastors as pacifiers in preparation for martial law. Nationwide initiative trains volunteers to teach congregations to obey the government, doing seize of guns, property, forced inoculations, and forced relocations. All right, that's deep. Pastors are being prepared to tell you what to do for martial law. And they're being taught by volunteers to obey the government. Let me read. A pastor has come forward to blow the whistle on a nationwide FEMA program, which is training pastors and other religious representatives to become secret police enforcers who teach their congregations to obey the government in preparation for a declaration of martial law. Property and firearms seized and forced relocation. So they're telling you that when martial law comes, the preachers are going to tell you to put the guns down, turn your guns in, don't fight, don't protect yourself, turn your guns in. In March of this year, so this was just this year, so listen, this article was in 2006, so this is when Bush passed that bill, that executive bill, but this is now 9 years later to where this we're reading is now full gear. Okay? It's in motion. In March of this year, the pastor who we shall refer to as Pastor Revere was invited to attend a meeting of his local FEMA chapter, which circulated around preparedness for a potential biased terrorist attack, any natural disasters or national declared emergencies. The FEMA directors told the pastors that attended that it was their job to help implement FEMA and Homeland Security directives in anticipation of any of these eventualities. The first directive was the pastors to preach to their congregations, Romans 13. So when they got taught, the very first thing they told the pastors to do was to preach to their congregations, Romans 13. All right? Teach to them Romans 13 and don't explain it. The often taken out of context Bible passage that was used by Hitler. So it says this is the same passage that was used by Hitler back in his days to hoodwink Christians into supporting him. So it ain't nothing new under the sun, you guys. They know what works. If Hitler did it back in the days to get the Christians to follow what he was doing, they're going to do the Christians the same way. In order to teach them to obey the government when martial law is declared. It was related to the pastors that quarantines, martial law, and forced relocations were a problem for state authorities when enforcing federal mandates due to cowboy mentality. So they said they brought all the pastors and said, hey, we're going to have a problem when we try to force martial law because majority of the people have a cowboy mentality. What's a cowboy mentality? We're going to shoot your head off if you come blowing my door. If you come trying to knock my door down with martial law, we're going to shoot your head off. So the government said, hey, we don't want that problem. We need you preachers to teach your people, the flock, that this is all right what we're doing so they can turn their guns in, so they can put their guns down. So as long as they put their guns down, now we don't have to worry about them shooting our heads off. Let me read it again. It was related to the pastors that quarantines, martial law, and forced relocations were a problem for the state authorities when enforcing federal mandates due to the cowboy mentality of citizens standing up for their property and Second Amendment rights, as well as farmers defending their crops and livestock from seizure. It was stressed that the pastors needed to preach subservience to the authorities ahead of time in preparations for the roundups and to make it clear to the congregation that this is for their own good. We have received confirmation from other preachers and pastors that this program is nationwide initiative and a literal Soviet model. So it's a model after the Soviet Union. All right, which is who? Hitler. So it's an initiative and a literal Soviet model whereby the churches are being systematically infiltrated by the government, volunteers, and used as conduits for martial law, training, and conditioning. The pastors were told that over 1,300 countries were already on board. So the pastors were told that everybody's on board except you guys. It falls under the umbrella of the INVO program. So the INVO program is what this falls under, which is training volunteers in a peer-to-peer program in a neighborhood setting. Pastors were told that the would-be backed up by law enforcement is controlling uncooperative individuals and that they would even lead SWAT teams in attempting this resistance. So listen. The pastors are being lied to, telling them, as long as you tell your people when martial law comes and FEMA camp comes, to go to the FEMA camp, and when martial law comes, we're going to help you guys lead the SWAT teams. Ain't that crazy? So let's go. So now let's go to Google. Go to Google and put in INVO programs. NVOAB program. I can't remember which one it is. I believe it's the first one. Somebody click on that. Does it say National Vol strategic plan. Anybody? Takes you to what?
Strategic plan, national
yearly. Yeah. Is that the first one? What'd you say, Brother James?
Could you just spell that for me again?
All right. NVOAD program. Nobody's found it? Hold on, let me go to it real fast. NVOAD program. Make sure everybody gets to where I'm at. Oh, it's number two. Go to the second link. So after you put in the ENVOAD program, it's number two. The second link. And the second link should say National VOL Strategic Plan. No, it's just the link number two. It just says, www.nvol.org. You find that? Okay, maybe it is a PDF document. I mean, I don't know. So now it says national. Did you guys get to that? Did it load? Yeah, that's it. It's link number two, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So National VOL Strategic Plan 2014 to 2016. Their vision, the vision 2016. So look, this is now, you guys. This ain't no article from 2 years ago, 5 years ago. This is now. It says vision 2016. National VOL will be reorganized, will be the reorganized non-governmental leader of the disaster preparedness response and recovery sector. National VOL members and partners represent a powerful force of goodwill in America. Through the VOL network, we provide the leadership that makes our communities stronger and more resilient in times of need. We deliver hope for a more positive future. Moving further along the path towards achieving our vision 2020 goals. So let's pay attention to this. All right. So you have to read between the lines to see what their strategy is. So it says that moving further along the path towards achieving our visions of 2020 goal. So it's telling you right here that they're about to start martial law at the end of 2015, somewhere right around 2016. And it's going to last until 2020. Y'all see what's going on here? It's going to last up to 4 years. Their goal is to keep people in FEMA camps and reprogram people for up to 4 years. And then after 4 years, once they have the new currency in place, once they have everything going, then their goal for 2020 will be to go back to what they call normal civilization. It's right here. They have a strategic plan, and their vision is to come together with these churches, because remember, we got the National VOL, which is a prayer program that's in cahoots with the pastors. So once the pastors teach you to go to the FEMA programs and to be on board with this program, and they're going to train you for 4 years from 2016 to 2020. And once 2020 comes, let's read their goals. Every relevant agency and organization of the public and private sector will understand National VOL and its member scope and mission. So by 2020, everybody will understand their mission. Everybody will understand what's going on because you've been in training for 4 years. All significant volunteer organizations active in disaster preparedness Responsible and Recovery with will be members of National Vogue. National Vogue will have partnership with organizations that support it and its member organization scope and missions. A significant portion of the American public will recognize National Vogue and its member scope and mission. Okay? Let's go down right there where it says 2016 goals. So just scroll down to where it says 2016 goals. And it says, all significant faith-based community based or other nonprofit organizations with a disaster service program and that mobilize volunteers and otherwise organization communities will be affiliated with the National Vogue movement. So it tells you right here, all churches, all nonprofit organizations with 501c3 will be a part of this movement. All National Vogue members will have access to a suite of support services that increase a member's ability and collaboratory service that their disaster service mission. New opportunities for National Vogue members organizations to share knowledge and expertise with state and local Vogue members will increase their national image and reputations as pillars of support for building community resiliency. So it's telling you right here that through this program, they're going to rebuild the reputation and the image of the community through this program. So they're going to tear the community down in 2016 with FEMA camps, with martial law. They're going to tear it all down. Everything's going to go to disaster. Okay? But through these programs, they're going to teach you and reprogram you. So by 2020, which is their goal, to bring everybody back out, and everybody's going to be on the same page. The image is going to be rebuilt. See, once they take you to the FEMA camps, you're going to be in disarray. People are going to be in disarray. But since the preachers are telling people to go to FEMA camps and everything's going to be all right, and once they take you to the FEMA camp, and then they're going to retrain you in the FEMA camp, you're going to be like, well, my preacher told me everything's cool. So once they start retraining you, you're going to be fine. And then after 4 years, once they release the doors and tell you you can go back out, you now have your chip, so we don't have to worry about you. You can go back out. You're a slave now. You have the chip. If you try to do something stupid, we'll just send the drone over there and take you out. So now that you're retrained, they said these organizations will rebuild the national image and reputation by 2020. This is their goal, you guys. So you have to understand what's happening here. Let's go to Ephesians 5:8. So when you put together when you read between the lines and put together their dots, that's all it is. You just got to connect the dots. They tell you everything that they're going to do right before your face. But a lot of people don't read the stuff and take the time to connect the dots. And when you connect the dots, it's clear as day, you guys, on what they're doing. It's right here. It's right here. I'm not an idiot, and I know other people that are reading this. Read the rest of this when you get a chance. Read the rest of this. But why would they be starting something in 2014 to 2016 and then have a goal to be somewhere by 2020 in 4 years? You put that together, that just lets you know that's how long they're planning on keeping people locked up. And then once everybody's chipped, now we can send you out. Because now once you're chipped and you're reprogrammed, now we don't have to worry about you. Because you've been reprogrammed, we don't have to worry about you going to getting your gun and trying to kill somebody. We don't have to worry about you getting your gun and trying to kill off the president. We don't have to worry about you getting your gun now and trying to kill off the troops that are in the streets. Because the troops, once they put these troops on the street in J-Hill, they're staying. They're never leaving ever again. The troops will become now the police. So how you see the police today, the troops are now here. They will replace the police. This is the protection now, the so-called protection. So in 2020, when people see the troops along the street, you won't go to grab your gun and try to fight them because you've been reprogrammed now. Ephesians 5:8. And it reads, "For ye were sometimes darkness. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Most High. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness and righteousness and truth, proving what is acceptable unto the Most High. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. So it tells us, listen, don't have no fellowship with these churches. So many people say, well, I just go to church because of family members. Yeah, I know they're not doing things right. And yeah, I know they're not following the Bible correctly. But, you know, family and friends and, you know, we have a good time. It says, have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of the darkness. So these churches are in cahoots with the government. These churches are leading the people the wrong way. So it says, have no fellowship with them, but rather reprove them. So if anything, you go to your preacher. Anybody that's a Christian, you hear this lesson, you go to your preacher and ask him about that executive order. You go ask him about the 501c3. If you ask your preacher, listen, just hit him on the slide and go ask him, hey, I was talking to a friend and they might be able to sponsor the church. Are we 501c3? Set them up. See what they say. I got a friend, my boss at work might want to sponsor some of our programs. Are we 501c3? Oh yeah, by the way, we are. Let me show you the paperwork. Run. Get out of there very quick, like Speedy Gonzalez. Okay? It's no time to be messing around with these people no more. Ephesians 5:12. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret. So it is a shame to speak of those things which are done in secret. And what I just read to you guys tonight was done in secret. It ain't like they came out on CNN News and told everybody what these churches are doing with the government. This stuff was done in secret. But all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light. For whatsoever doeth make manifest is light. Wherefore he said, awake thou that art sleeping, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Yeshua shall give thee light. Ephesians 15:5. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. So the days we live in are very evil. Okay? But it says, arise and awake that our sleep is. Yeshua shall give you light. So us that is on this line, us that is doing our church out of our homes, we have been awake. We're no longer asleep. The people that are waking up every Sunday, the people that are wake up doing brotherhood on Mondays, doing choir rehearsal on Tuesday, doing Usher board on Thursday, all these people are still asleep going to these churches. All right, so it's time to leave that evil world and don't let Satan deceive you anymore. Satan has made everything look very glamorous. So that's why these people continue to go to these churches, because through these preachers, Satan has made everything look glamorous and made everything fun. So when people go to church, the preachers have a bunch of fun activities going on. People are dancing. Like I say, they're doing all kind of skits, and the skits is all kind of just evil things. So they're making it fun to the people. It's glamorous. Let's go to 2 Corinthians 11:13. So through the glamour work of the preachers, that's what's keeping the members. That's what's making people come and pay their tithes. Because they be like, man, at my church, we have so much fun. Church ain't supposed to be about fun. The word of the Most High is supposed to be about fun. Yeah, it's fun through the Spirit to fellowship with your brothers and sisters and know you got other people doing the same work as you. But hey, this is serious business here, what we're doing. Yeah, when we do our holy days, yeah, that's fun. We fellowship, we have fun, we do things. But on a normal basis, this is serious business. This is a job. And it's going to be rough. Ain't nobody say this is easy, because when you go talk to people and you try to wake people up, it's going to be rough. You're going to get pushback. So it ain't nothing fun about what we got going on here. 2 Corinthians 11:13. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of the Messiah. So it tells you right here, these apostles, these preachers, these deceitful workers have transformed themselves into ministers of the Messiah. Okay? Verse 14. 2 Corinthians 11:14. And no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is It is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their work. So it tells you that Satan himself is transformed as an angel of light, which is the government. Satan is the government. And he transformed his ministers into righteous people. So people think these ministers are righteous, but they're not. They're deceitful workers of the government, which is Satan. Ezekiel 13:1. So you have to understand, you guys, Satan, he has powers. And his powers can be in the glamorous works of his evil works. And people don't understand that. Just because Satan is Satan doesn't mean everything he does looks evil. No, Satan can make something look very glamorous. And that's what you have going on with his preachers. These fancy looking preachers with fancy cars, big houses. They look good. And they be up there and they make you feel good. When you come down the aisle bringing your tithes, the preacher giving you compliments. Yeah, Sister Johnson, I seen that nice car today. That's the way you do it. They pumping your head up to make you continue to come. Always giving you compliments. Ezekiel 13:1. And it reads, And the word of the Most High came unto me, saying, Son of man, prophesy against the prophets of Israel that prophesy, and say thou unto them that prophesy out of their own hearts. So we already read that these ministers are not supposed to be reading and prophesying and reading scriptures and interpreting from their own hearts. And say thou unto them that prophesy out of their own hearts, hear ye the word of the Most High. Thus saith the Most High Ahiah, woe unto the foolish prophets that follow their own spirit and have seen nothing. So these dudes ain't seen nothing. That's why they're going to the government and getting this money and being deceived by the government and teaching you what the government wants. Because if they have seen the prophecy of Ahiah, they wouldn't be getting no 501c3 and be getting told what to do. Once you see the prophecy of Ahiah, you run from the government. You teach against the government. Verse 4, Ezekiel chapter 13, verse 4. O Israel, thy prophets are like the foxes in the desert. So they're eating you people up. These people are scavengers. Ye have not gone up into the gaps, neither made up the hedge for the house of Israel to stand in the battle in the day of the Most High. So it's telling these prophets, you're not teaching these people what they need to do in the day of the battle, which is martial law. Martial law is the day of battle against the highest people. Taking people to the FEMA camps is the day of battle against the highest people, which is Israel. And it says, ye have not gone up into the gaps, neither made up the hedge of the house of Israel to stand in the day of battle. So these preachers are supposed to be teaching these people what they're supposed to be doing in the day of battle. You have to teach the flock how they're supposed to react in the day of battle, which is martial law. Not teach them to go be with martial law. Not teach them how to go with the government. You got to build that hedge over Israel, which is what we do. We teach Israel who they are. Build the hedge. That way when that day comes, we're not scared of the government. We getting out of here. We're doing what we got to do because we have that hedge to stand in the day of battle. And hedge means fence or wall, to build that wall. Okay? And it says you have not gone into the gaps. Let's break down the scripture on the word gaps and breaches. Gaps just means, the word gaps just means breaches. So that's what gaps mean, the breaches. Let's go to Isaiah 58:12. So when you look up the word gaps, it just means breaches. Isaiah 58:12 says, and they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste place. What's the old waste place? Israel. Build Israel. That's what these preachers should be doing. Building Israel. You're going to church and you're teaching these people who they are. Telling them what they should do according to Ahiah. Teaching them how to follow the laws and the commandments. Build the old waste place, which is Israel. Thou shalt raise up the foundations of many generations. So the foundation of many generations. And thou shalt be called. So if a minister ain't doing this, he ain't been ordained by Ahiah. So these preachers that are going around talking about they ordained, but they're not teaching the word of Ahiah and building up the gaps of Israel, is a false liar. And thou shalt be called the repairer of the breach, the restorer of the past to dwell in. So that's what a true minister, that's what a true teacher of Ahiah does. A true teacher of Ahiah repairs, he's a repairer of the breaches. That's what he's called. He's repairing the gaps. What's the gaps? All this loose history that we've been taught, all this loose and lost history through the schools and through all the philosophy, they taught you their history, so now there's loose information. So now when we find our information, we're repairing the history that we've been taught. So that's what the preachers should be doing. Lamentations 2 and 14, you don't got no preachers out there doing that in these churches. They're not repairing your history. If anything, they're adding on to the history that you've been taught, making the breach bigger, putting you further and further away from Ahiah. That's what the breach is. The breach is the history that you've been taught, and then it separates you from the true power, which is Ahiah. But when the preacher repairs those breaches, it brings you closer and closer, and before you know, you look up. Bam, there goes Ahiah. Bam, there goes Yeshayah. Rewalk. Lamentations 2 and 14. Thy prophets have seen vain and foolish things for thee, and they have not discovered thy iniquity to turn away thy captivity, but have seen for their false burdens and caused the banishment. So it tells you that these prophets that are, these preachers that are in charge, have seen vain and foolish things for thee. That's why they teach you vain and foolish things. That's why they're going to teach you to go to the FEMA camps, because they have seen vain and foolish things. They have not discovered thy iniquity. See, a preacher should be in the pulpit teaching you what you're doing wrong. If you're a sinner and if you're doing wrong, that preacher should be teaching you and pulling you to the side and calling you, hey brother, I seen some stuff that you were doing. Hey, that's not what we're supposed to do. Hey sister, hey, nah, get away, get rid of that jealousy. Hey, get rid of all that. But these preachers ain't doing this. These preachers are lying to the pulpit. I mean, to the congregation. These preachers are telling people what they want to hear. So therefore, they're not turning people away from their captivity. We are in captivity here in America. We need to be taught that. You need to be taught that this place you're living in is not yours and you're in captivity. Not to be taught that this place is a beautiful place and when FEMA camps come, go run into them. No, we're taught that this is captivity. Break down banishment. Banishment is H 40-65, so it says, but have seen for thee false burdens. So these preachers have seen for you, since they're teaching the wrong thing, they have seen for you false burdens and causes of banishment. Banishment is H 40-65. And H 40-65 is Madawak. Madawak. And Madawak is M-A-D-A-W-A-C-H. Madawak. And Madawak is seduction, which is banishment. So banishment is Madawak, and it means seduction. So this is where all the seduction in church, all the lust, different things like that is coming from. It's coming through the preachers. The preachers are teaching you how to be a seductive individual. Let's break down the word seduction. Seduction in the Webster. The word seduction means the act of seducing or of enticing from the path of duty. Let me read it again. Seduction means the act of seducing or of enticing from the path of duty. So these preachers are seducing people in a way to where it's taking them out of their path. It's taking the people out of their path. Because the preacher is seducing you with words that you like to hear, letting you do what you want, and it's enticing you to where you're liking what they got going on, and it's taking you out of your path. What's your path? Following the higher, following the laws and the commandments, learning who Israel is. So they're taking you out of your path. They got you doing things that are that don't have nothing to do with the higher. Let's go to, I want to get a scripture on how they're taking you out of your path. I want to say it's Isaiah, let me see, Isaiah 30 and 10, yeah, Isaiah 30 and 10, go to Isaiah 30 and 10, let me give you a precept on what these, this is another precept on what these preachers are doing, how they're taking you out of your path, how they're seducing you. Isaiah 30 and 10 reads, which say to the seers, see not, and to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things. Speak unto us smooth things, prophesy deceit. So this is what the congregation, this is what the members are saying to the preachers. Prophesy not unto us right things. Don't teach us right things. We don't want to be told the truth, preacher. We like coming to you because you don't teach us the proof. Speak unto us smooth things. Tell us what we want to hear. Prophesy deceits. Prophesy deceits. Don't tell us about Israel. Don't tell us that we're in captivity. Don't tell us that we're the true people of the Bible. Don't tell us that the Messiah is black. Get you out of the way. Turn aside out of the path. Cause the Holy One of Israel to cease before us. So it says, remember, seduction means the act of seducing or enticing from the path of duty. Isaiah, verse 11, chapter 30 says, get you out of the way, turn aside out of the path. Cause the Holy One of Israel to cease before us. Who is the Holy One of Israel? Yeshua. Cease him before us. Get us out of our path. Teach us smooth things. Prophesy and deceit. So when these preachers prophesy and deceit, it's taking the people and teaching them smooth things, it's taking you right out of your path. Which is your, what's the path? Everybody should know what the path is. Listen, like I tell y'all all the time, I don't care how smart you is, I don't care how much you learned in the truth, there's only one path. I don't care how many groups there are on YouTube, I don't care how many people think they know more than the other person, there's only one path, and that path is salvation. And if you're not stressing every day on how to work on, stand on the road to salvation, you're doing wrong. That's the only thing that we should be focusing on every day, every week, every month is salvation. That's our path. Let's go back to Ezekiel 13 and 6. So that's the path that you should be thinking about. Every time you say, well, what's my path? Or what's your path? Salvation, brother. Salvation is the path for all of us. And if you ain't focused on salvation, then come here and take a seat so that I can give you some precepts and show you what you need to start doing to focus on salvation. Ezekiel 13 and 6. Like I said, I don't care, man. You got so many people on YouTube arguing about who knows more, who's doing more. That brother's wrong, this brother's wrong. Listen, it ain't about that, man. If every week we all, if we only had one scripture left, we should hope that it's salvation. Teaching on how to find salvation. It ain't about all that other stuff. Let's teach everybody how to find the road to salvation. Ezekiel 13 and 6 reads, they have seen vanity and lying divination, saying, the Most High said, and the Most High had not sent them. So the Most High ain't sent these dudes. These preachers that are following the government, 501c3. Most High ain't sent these people. Who are y'all? And they have made others to hope that they would confirm the word. So they got people hoping that they are going to bring the truth. They got, these preachers got the congregation hoping that they are bringing the, I know my preacher, yeah, he's, I trust in him. No. Have ye not seen a vain vision? And have ye not spoken a lying divination? Whereas ye say, the Most High said, I'll bet I have not spoken. So Most High said, I ain't spoken what these people saying. These people in the pulpit saying the Most High said this. The Most High said to go teach these people to go to FEMA camps. There's nowhere in the scriptures where the Most High says when disaster comes to teach the people to run to the government. He said, I ain't say that. I ain't telling people to do that. 2 Peter 2:1. Most High ain't told nobody. He ain't told nobody to go deal with the government. Government don't have nothing to do with the Most High. 2 Peter 2:1 says, but there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among them, who privately shall bring a damnable heresy, even denying the Most High that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways. By reason of them, the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. All right? So, pernicious ways just means physical, spiritual, or eternal. That's what pernicious ways mean. Pernicious ways means physical, spiritual, or eternal. Verse 3. And through covetousness shall they with fine words make merchandise of you. So they're making merchandise of you. They're making money off of you. You're a gold mine. Sitting in those churches, the congregation, the preachers are making merchandise off of you. Whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. So these people, these false teachers, these false preachers, their destruction is coming. They're leading themselves to swift destruction. And not only are they leading themselves to swift destruction, they're leading the congregation to swift destruction. Let's go to John 14:30. Let me show you how the government is working after Satan. But yet the government is teaching these preachers what to do in the end days. That's all bad. The government is teaching the preachers what to do in the end days. And the government is the kings of the earth. All right? Not the kings of Ohio, but the kings of this earth is your government. John 14:30 says, hereafter, I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh and had nothing in me. So Yeshaya right here was talking to the disciples. And this was one of his last conversations that he had with the disciples. He gathered the disciples and said, come here. And he told them, hereafter I will not talk much with you. So he warned the disciples, this is going to be like one of our last conversations. I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh. Who is the prince? Satan. So he was warning the disciples, after this conversation, I'm not going to talk much with you, and Satan is coming. And had nothing in me, and he has nothing in me. So the government, which is ran by Satan, has nothing of Yeshaya in them. They're all false. False liars and false deceivers. Alright, let's get to the last few precepts of the night. Let's get to Ezekiel 34:2. So you have to understand that the government that has the dollar bill that says, in God we trust, is not the God of Exodus. I mean, is not the God of Exodus 3:13, which is a high El Shaddai. It ain't him. Okay? It's the God of Baal, which is Baphomet, which is who they follow. Okay? Overall, they follow Baphomet, which is all these different gods, which is under the power of Satan. Satanism. So, anybody that watched this, I hope you will learn a few things that your church that has now, you was a kid, you going to the same church for 15 years, and when you was a kid, it was a little shack hole. And now it's one of the biggest buildings on the block. And you should say to yourself, how did that happen? Yeah, well, they found out about the 501c nonprofit, and the government funded them all this money to become who they are. Ezekiel 34:2. Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say unto them, thus saith the Most High thy power unto the shepherds. Woe be to the shepherds of Israel that do feed themselves. Should not the shepherd feed the flocks? So it's telling you, prophesy unto the Ezekiel, son of man, prophesy unto these shepherds that feed themselves and not the flock. And that's what you have going on in these churches. These churches are getting fed by the flock. The flock is robbing them. I mean, the churches is robbing the flocks. Tithes and offerings. But then the pastor is not turning around and feeding them the word. That's why it says, should not the shepherds feed the flock? Shouldn't the shepherd be taking care of the flock with the word, taking care of them on the holy days, taking care of them through the spirit, feeding them the word? How do we know it means when it says, should the shepherd be feeding the flocks? How do we know that's talking about scriptures? Let's go to Ezekiel. Hold on, I believe it's Ezekiel 2 and 9. Let's go to Ezekiel 2 and 9. Let's see that when it says the shepherd, it's not saying that the shepherd should be feeding the flock food. See, that's what's wrong with people of the world today. They read these scriptures and they take it out of context in the wrong way. It's not saying that the shepherd should be feeding these people food, dinner and stuff. No, it's talking about this word. Ezekiel 2 and 9 reads, and when I looked, behold, a hand was sent unto me, and lo, a roll of a book was therein. And he spread it before me, and it was written without and within. And there was written therein lamentations, and mourning, and woe. What's lamentations? Lamentation is speaking of this book. Okay? Lamentation is speaking of this these scriptures. Let's go to chapter 3, Ezekiel 3. Let's continue on. Ezekiel 3 and 1 says, moreover, he said unto me, son of man, eat that thou findest, eat this roll, and go speak unto the house of Israel. So I opened my mouth, and he caused me to eat the roll. So Ezekiel ate the roll. So he told Ezekiel, eat the roll, which is this book, and then go speak to the house of Israel. And that's what the shepherd should be doing. Eating his Bible and speaking to them the truth, but they're not doing that. They're reading the Bible, scanning through the Bible. They got the Bible on what is it called? When you put your music on, what, and it scans through the music? What's it?
Shuffle.
The Bible, these preachers have their brain on shuffle mode. They shuffle through the scriptures and play with the scriptures. They're not eating this roll and teaching these people what's in this. Let's go back to Ezekiel 34 and 2. Ezekiel 34 and 2 says, son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say unto them, thus saith the Most High thy power unto the shepherds. Woe be to the shepherds of Israel that do feed themselves. Should not the shepherds feed the flock? Ye eat the fat. Yea, eat the fat, and ye clothe with you, and ye clothe you with the wool. Ye kill them that are fed, but ye feed not the flock. So you don't feed the flock. The disease have ye not strengthened, neither have ye healed that which was sick, neither have ye bound up that which was broken, neither have ye brought again that which was driven away, neither have ye sought that which was lost, but with force and with cruelty have you ruled them. So it says you rule these people with force, with cruelty. These preachers are cruel. They convince these people that they should pay tithes. And I've been to churches to where if you ain't paying tithes, the preacher don't even really speak to you. That's cruelty. But it says, the disease have you not strengthened. We have been diseased. Israel has been diseased through the government of America, through the teachings, through everything. We've been diseased. And we have not been strengthened through these preachers. We've been, people that's on this line, you've been strengthened now through the right word. Neither have ye healed the sick, neither have you bound up which was broken, neither have you brought again which was driven away. We have been driven away, the Most High driven us away and put us in a land that we knew not, and took away our heritage. He put us in the hands of the evil. So the preacher should be teaching that, hey, the Most High driven you away, put you in the land of the evil. Now the preacher should be bringing us back. That's what this verse right here said. They should be bringing us back, which was lost. They're not doing that. Verse 5. Ezekiel chapter 34, verse 5. And they were scattered because there is no shepherd. And they became meat to all the beasts of the field when they were scattered. Who was the beast? America. So now we are meat unto America. America is just feasting off Israel because the shepherds are not teaching the people right. Okay? And the meat is going to get taken right to the beast. The beast don't even got to come out and hunt no more. Because the meat is going to be delivered to them on the plate when these preachers are teaching the people to go to the FEMA camps. The Most High says you should be teaching these people that was lost. My sheep wandered through all the mountains and upon every high hill. Yea, my flock was scattered upon all the face of the earth, and none did search or seek after them. Therefore, ye shepherds, hear the words of the Most High. As I live, saith the Most High, Ahiah. Surely because my flock became a prey, and my flock became meat to every beast of the field, because there was no shepherd, neither did my shepherds search for my flock. But the shepherds fed themselves and fed not my flock. And that's what you had. These Israel preachers, these Judites, these Judah preachers, Gadites, all these preachers that's under Israel that's teaching, they're not teaching the people right. I can go to South Phoenix right now and I see a church on every block, every corner, and none of those Judah brothers are feeding the flock. They're feeding themselves with their pockets. Fattening their pockets and not feeding the flock the right word. Not giving them the true role of the book. Verse 9, Ezekiel chapter 37, verse 9. Therefore, O ye shepherds, hear the words of the Most High. Thus saith the Most High, thy power. Behold, I am against the shepherds, and I will require my flock at their hand, and cause them to cease from feeding the flock. Neither shall the shepherds feed themselves anymore. For I will deliver my flock from their mouth, that they may not be meat for them. So that's what's happened to us. Majority of us was raised in churches. We went to churches, and the Most High has delivered us from the mouths of the shepherd. So we cannot be meat no more. So that's why every morning you wake up, you should thank Ahiah and say, thank you for waking me up and getting me out of that meat house. Ezekiel 22 and 24. That's your prayer to Ahiah. Thank you for shining that light on me and taking me out of that meat market. Because all he was doing was feasting on me and teaching me wrong and doing me wrong. So now that you've been woke, listen, I know everybody got family members that go to church and it's hard to break away, but now that you've broken away, thank the Most High on a daily basis that he did such. Ezekiel 22 and 24 reads, we got about 5 minutes left. Son of man, say unto her, thou art the land that is not cleansed. Who was her? America. America is her. Look up the word America and then come back to me and tell me what the word America means. It's a her. Son of man, say unto her, thou art the land that is not cleansed, nor rain upon in the day of indignation. So this land is disease infected, is not cleansed. There is a conspiracy of her prophets, but we're the conspiracy theorists. When you go talking to people and start telling them the truth, they ask you. I hear so many times when I start telling people the truth and telling them, showing them scriptures in the Bible, are you some type of conspiracy theorist? No, I'm not no conspiracy theorist. I'm a righteous man in the name of Ahiah. Ezekiel 22 and 25. There is a conspiracy of her prophets in the midst thereof, like a roaring lion raving the prey. They have devoured souls. They have taken the treasure and precious things. They have made her many windows. They have made her many windows in the midst thereof. So they're like roaring lions. The government is like roaring lions for Judah, for Israel. They love to see that we don't know what we're talking about because they just prey on you. Her priests have violated my law. So that's why all these preachers, they're in the church teaching, you don't have to follow the law no more. And as long as they're teaching, you don't have to follow the law no more. They're in violation. We already broke that down earlier, right? Her priests have violated my law and have profaned my holy things. They have put no difference between the holy and profane. So everybody's the same. That's why the Pope last week got up and did a big old conference saying that it is right for gays to come into church. And if you have a problem with a gay coming into church, something is wrong with you. So they're bringing the profane amongst the holy. But none of them are holy. All of them are profane. Neither have they showed difference between the unclean and the clean, and have hid their eyes from my Sabbaths. And I am profane among them. So I hid my eyes from the Sabbath. That's a perfect precept to give to somebody that's going to church on Sunday. That's what that means. You have hid your eyes from my Sabbath. You don't worship me on the day that I tell you, which is Friday evening to Saturday evening. You hide your eyes from those days, but you're quick to run and worship on Sunday. Her princes in the midst thereof are like wolves raving the prey, to shed blood and to destroy souls, to get dishonest gain. So that's what they got going on, dishonest gain. They're getting gain through the tithes and offerings, and it's through dishonesty. Her prophets have daubed them with untempered mortar, seeing vanity and divining lies unto them, saying, thus saith the Most High, High, when the Most High has not spoken. So we read that precept earlier in Ezekiel 13, and saying it again right here, that they're saying these lies unto them comes from Ahiah. All these lies that they're giving to the people, they're saying, claiming that it's coming from Ahiah. And Ahiah said, I ain't spoken that. Verse 29, Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 29. The people of the land have used oppression and exercised robbery, and have vexed the poor and needy. Yea, they have oppressed the stranger wrongfully. So now that the churches are working through the government and being paid, they have exercised robbery. They are robbing the people. Every time they take their tithes and not feeding them back the true word, they are robbing the people. Point blank. There's nothing else to be said about it. Verse 30. And I sought for a man among them that should make up the hedge and stand in the gap before me for the land, that I should not destroy it, but I found none. So the Most High says, through all these preachers, I found none of them right. They ain't not building up the hedge. All right. They are not teaching the people what they should know. And the Most High says that's what should be done up there. They should be building that, bridging that gap. Like I said earlier, what's bridging the gap? By teaching people the true history and bringing them closer to Ahiah, versus teaching them false lies and false doctrine to make them go further and further out of the path of Ahiah. All right. So now we went over some information tonight to show you how the churches and the government are in the same bed. And majority of these churches are the 501c3 churches. But let me tell you something. Don't be naive. It's majority of all these churches. They don't even have to be 501c3. Because now, even if the church ain't made it to 501c3 status, the small preachers are still being taught by who? The bigger preachers. Because the small preachers are what? Trying to do everything they can to be like the big preachers that's under the 501c3. So now the small churches, they are doing everything. They are under the wings of the big preachers. So now the big preachers are teaching the small preachers what they need to do to get to their status. Come on. There ain't not one preacher out there that don't want what that big preacher has. So he's going to the big preacher and trying to follow the ways of him. And sooner or later, that small preacher will be 501c3 and be trained the same way the big preacher has been trained. And this is what we're getting in the last days, you guys. All the false teachers, all the false prophets that you read of in Matthew 24, all of those preachers lying and saying that they coming in the name of Yeshua, they're not coming in the name of Yeshua. They're coming in the name of DHS. They're coming in the name of, Nouveau? They're coming in the name of the Nouveau program. They're not coming in the name of Yeshua. So now that you have some more solid information to go give to your family and friends, because I know it's a fight. Listen, I know it's a fight. I know it's not easy. It's a fight when you try to go talk to your family and friends and tell them that the churches are corrupt, the name Jesus is Greek and it's satanic, it's Zeus. They don't want to hear you. But now you have some more information to show them from tonight, along with the information we went over last week with the JM. All these lessons that we've done, the last four lessons that we've done, is all tied together. We did two lessons over the last 2 weeks over martial law. Martial law part one, martial law part two. I'm going to get those videos up. I promise you, I will. I've already tried to upload them 4 times and YouTube will not allow me to upload the 2 martial law videos. I don't know what's going on. They're blocking them. Yes, I'm going to say it again. YouTube, I've tried to upload martial law 1 and martial law 2 video 4 times over the last week and YouTube will not allow it to go up. They will not process it. So that lets you know that every time I try to upload a video, that's why it takes a little over an hour and a half for it to upload, because they're processing the information. They will not let me upload the videos. But that's okay. I'll get them up some way or another. Those 2 videos, and then we did a lesson on plagues and GMOs, on how your food is now being vaccinated. The vaccines are now in your food. So now you're opting out not to get your kids and yourselves vaccinated, and they found a way through the GMOs to put vaccinations in your food. The mosquitoes now have vaccinations. So they're finding different ways to destruct the Most High's people. And then along with tonight's lesson, you tie all those lessons, those the last 4 lessons together, and you have a lot of solid information to go talk to people with. So with that in mind, we'll say Shalom, all praises to the Most High. We'll pray it out. And then we'll open it up for any type of discussion or any type of prayer, any type of questions. All right, so let's pray it out.